dedicated to each and every one of you who appreciate a great glass of wine. You know what I mean?
It's Monday. Let's raise a glass to the beginning of another week. It's time to unscrew, uncork, or saber a bottle. And let's begin exploring the wine glass. Today, I'm sharing another audio recording of the online seminar I attended from the Oregon Wine Board. This week, we are discovering Rogue Valley. Directly from their site, Southern Oregon is home to many international varieties that are thriving and garnering a lot of attention. With distinctively crafted wines from vineyards among the best in the world, the Rogue Valley is a community of accessible, craft-driven wine growers fueled by the awe of our wild and scenic valley, who invite explorers, makers, and inspiration seekers to discover and connect with the natural wonders of Oregon's Rogue Valley. This seminar, once again, led by Master of Wine, Bree Stock. While you're listening, please take a moment to rate and review Exploring the Wine Glass. Ratings are now available pretty much wherever you are listening to this podcast. It is the best way to support Exploring the Wine Glass by allowing others to find it. Sláinte. Hey everybody, I'm Lori Budd, a UC Davis winemaking program, sommelier service, champagne specialist, and WSET Level 2 graduate. You can find Exploring the Wine Glass on all the socials as well as your favorite podcast catchers. If you haven't subscribed yet, now's the perfect time to swipe, subscribe, rate, and review. I promise I'll never tell you what to drink, but I'll always share what's in my glass.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the fourth installment of Oregon Wine Month's webinars, and today we're exploring the Rogue Valley.
I'm David DeWitt. I'm the Trade Relations Manager for the Oregon Wine Board. Bree is our Director of Education. She is an MW. She's been doing a great job. This is her fourth, and we're really excited to talk about the Rogue Valley. It's a really dynamic and wild growing region with fantastic wines. Bree, I will let you take it over.
Thank you, David. And as David mentioned, please put any questions into the chat or Q&A section, and David and I will be monitoring those and trying to answer them as swiftly as possible. Today we're exploring one of my favorite regions in the state. It's such a diverse and just breathtakingly stunning region that every turn is completely different. It's incredibly mountainous, incredibly wild with amazing rivers, and is just a real treat to be able to explore. And because of all of those, the complex diversity of the microclimates and the geography itself, we're capable of growing several different varieties down here. So we're gonna get into what sets each region apart in the Rogue Valley and talk a little bit about the wine styles and varieties that come from here. So we'll give you some background first. So we are jumping right on into Southern Oregon. So you can see here, the Willamette Valley is further north. About 150 miles from Portland is where the Southern Oregon AVA begins. It was established in 2005 as an all-encompassing AVA that spreads from just south of Eugene all the way down to the California border, and really encompasses two distinctive growing regions. And we're going to talk about the Umpqua Valley, which is the Southern Oregon's northern partner, in next week's webinar. And today we're going to focus on the more southerly Rogue Valley. There are several thousand acres planted here. The entire Southern Oregon AVA is just a little under the size of the Willamette Valley. And planted area is increasing swiftly across both AVAs, but really notably in the Rogue Valley. There's a lot of interest and diversity in plantings taking hold down here. I want to point out to you on this map, just some of the major geographical influences that really impact some of the grape growing, the distinctiveness of the region down here. So Rogue Valley is right in the south. It's higher elevation than both the Umpqua Valley and the Willamette Valley. It's some of the highest elevation vineyards in the state, where vineyards generally start around 1,000 feet to 2,000 feet in elevation, which makes for a pretty dramatic area to be able to plant grape varieties. As you can see on this map as well, the region is really crisscrossed by river systems. And again, these river systems help to provide varied benchlands, different aspects of slope. And so down in the Rogue Valley, more than anywhere else in the state, you see people planting on both north and south facing hillsides, which allow you to plant very different grape varieties depending on the northerly or southerly exposure. We also have, again, the Pacific Ocean to the west, which is buffered by the Siskiyou Mountains. So the impact of that Pacific Ocean is really buffered by the Siskiyou Mountains in the southwest of the state. And that helps protect the Rogue Valley and specifically the Illinois Valley, which is the outer valley there, and the Applegate Valley. We'll talk about that a little more as we dig into it. And then as we move to the east, we again have those more volcanic and down here really basalt columns, very dramatic volcanic cascade ranges. And then south along the California border is the Klamath Mountain Range as well. So very protected and sheltered in those areas as well. So just keep this orientation in mind, and I'll bring these maps up again quite often as well. But again, that south and north aspects facing vineyard slopes allow us to plant everything from Pinot Gris and Chardonnay through to Pinot Gris, Riesling, Syrah, Tempranillo, Tanat, you name it, it is in the Rogue Valley. So Southern Oregon as an AVA as a whole is the largest, second largest growing region in the state. It makes up for about 24% of the entire vineyard plantings in the state. And again, that unique diverse geology, the carved out rivers and mountain streams really create for many different varieties to thrive. And as you can see, Pinot Noir is still dominant in Southern Oregon. However, there's several other grape varieties that are swiftly taking up space in all of these vineyards. And again, the Rogue Valley is really only limited by the creativity and plant material that's actually available. There's a real curiosity to the wine growers and winemakers and grape growers down in this region. And they really love to explore and are not fazed by anything. And because of all of the varied climates and river systems, a lot of grape varieties can be grown really successfully, very high quality, and really affordable as well. So a great region to come and explore if you're able to get out this way. It's not too far from San Francisco as a drive, and is about 5 hours drive from Portland. So we'll jump into the climate. So the temperature in the Rogue Valley and precipitation is it's much warmer during the growing season and much cooler during the winter, with much heavier snowfall and cool weather coming into the fall and winter months. So the snowpack in the winters are really providing any irrigation waters that are in pretty much essential for grape growing in the Rogue Valley. There are some pockets of vineyards where you don't require irrigation, but the majority of vineyards are requiring irrigation in this area simply because of the heat and then the very alluvial and quickly draining soils in the area. It's one of the warmest AVAs in Oregon, and the temperatures in the summer are very much, like the Willamette Valley in the north, but they're extended into this summer period. So in the north, we'll generally have, a couple of days in the 90s and high 80s, But in the south, in the Rogue Valley, that those temperatures really do push up pretty quickly, beginning in May and coming through into the end of September. So pretty dry, driest area in the state. But what is really important here and what is sort of essential to the style and quality of the wines in this area, being very vibrant and having incredible acidity, incredible fruit purity and ripeness, is the fact that they have this long dry growing season, but they have a very large diurnal temperature swing. So that temperature difference between nighttime and daytime temperatures really allows for the acids in the grapes to be preserved and for the grapes to recover from the heat of the day in the early afternoon and into the evening when the temperature drops significantly. Another factor in this valley is that the winds, because of the vast river and mountain systems, these winds that push in from the Pacific Ocean, the area of the valley heats up in the center and really creates a vacuum that sucks in these Pacific Ocean winds in the late afternoon. And so these winds will really drive through these valleys, the Applegate and Illinois valleys first and foremost, and then into the Bear Creek Valley, which is the eastern side of the Rogue Valley. And these winds can really shut down the stomatas in the plants and again sort of delay that ripening. So you're getting this very protracted ripening over a long, warm, dry summer. And it really adds to A, the quality, but also the number of grape varieties that you're able to grow here successfully. So again, it's really difficult to simplify, and you really don't want to simplify the Rogue Valley. It's such a creative and dynamic region to explore and to taste through. There's more than 70 grape varieties grown here. And despite, Pinot Noir dominating, there are a number of producers in the area who make very delicate, ethereal Pinot Noirs from high elevation and south-facing sites, and then that are very comparative to the highest quality Pinot Noirs in the state. And then you also have the ability to grow very ripe Zinfandel and Bordeaux varieties that are grown along these bench lands of the river systems here. So if you look at this, this map here, you have really three distinct valleys. So starting on the western side near the Pacific Ocean, that small valley before the Applegate along the Illinois River, the Illinois Valley, is really one of the coolest areas for grape growing in the state, and really makes incredibly complex and aromatic fruit. So cool climate, aromatic grape varieties, Riesling thrives, Pinot Gris, Muscat, and again, Pinot Noir, really successful in this western cool valley, which has really lovely free-draining soils. It was an ancient river system. And this is sort of something that defines the Rogue Valley as well, is that all of these river systems really have tended to move over time. And so all of the vineyards that are planted are actually former river systems and riverbeds. And so very free draining, pretty nutrient poor soil systems that allow for really expressive grape growing, especially with that diurnal shift as well. The Applegate River runs that sort of diagonal, and it starts in California and runs north into the Rogue River Valley. And so this Applegate River Valley, the vineyards tend to be planted on bench lands here, and then moving further east again as you get towards Medford and Grants Pass. Grants Pass is the slightly lower elevation area, and as you move further south towards Ashland, you tend to rise in elevation as you move into the Klamath Mountains. and the Cascades. And so that entire area is the warmest of all areas and runs, you know, is really dependent on your elevation. So growing everything from Pinot Noir and Pinot Gris through to Bordeaux varieties and Rhone varieties on that eastern side. Again, a lot of river system soils, but also eroded volcanics coming down into those river valleys and adding some complexity to these soils and clay soils as well, which help to retain the water here. So we'll go in a little bit into the soils now. So the three major soil types are the marine sedimentary bedrock, volcanic cascade mountain sediments that have eroded over time and traveled with the rain and snow down into the valley floor, and silicea terrains. And then, of course, the majority is a lot of these stream sediments and granitic gravels and rocky beds that really line a lot of these high quality Rhone varietal sites. So ancient soils, these are some of the most ancient soils in all of Oregon in the Rogue Valley. So 200 million years ago, the Pacific Ocean stretches to Idaho until the Wandafuca Plate and the North American Plate start to brush up against each other, and the Wandafuca Plate subducts under the North American Plate. And this raises Oregon out of the ocean, if you will. And so we have all of these ocean island pieces and ocean bottom, which are stuck onto the west coast as these plates smash together, and they create some of the oldest mountains here in Oregon. So very ancient soils are exposed in the Rogue Valley. Then we have the volcanic uplifts that occur. So 50 million years ago, the Cascade volcanic soils start to form. And then we have the silicea volcanic soils forming from underwater volcanoes that are erupting, and also inland as well. And so these volcanic sediments are primarily in the northern part of the state, but also the northern part of southern Oregon. The one thing that Southern Oregon isn't influenced by is that flood system of the Missoula floods. It doesn't make the Missoula floods don't make it down to Southern Oregon. So none of these windblown soils or alluvial sediments are from the Missoula floods. So very all of these soil series are created by the carving of river systems that are running off the mountains and out to the ocean. So all of these ancient river systems that create all of these amazing alluvial fans and benchlands around the mouths of the river and the each left bank and right bank of both the Rogue River and the Applegate River. So flowing out, the Rogue River has changed course many times over its life, and this is where we find some of the most interesting Bordeaux and Rhone vineyard sites in the Rogue Valley. So very free draining soil, quite poor soil, but it also, all of those river rocks and sediments tend to condense together so that they're really preserving some of the moisture that falls during the winter and provides a consistent water supply to the vines. History of grape growing and winemaking in the Rogue Valley. This is such an important valley in terms of history. In the 1850s, pioneers and settlers came to this valley initially for mining purposes, so gold mining purposes, and all of the services that surrounded, gold mining and mining in general, really brought a lot of people here in the 1850s. So in Peter Britt was one of those people who came here, and instead of you know, following the mining bent, he fell in love with the agriculture that could be grown in the area. And he introduced some of the first grapes to the area and founded the first bonded winery in Oregon in 1858. That winery is still around today, although it hasn't always been a bonded winery. So it has not, it's not a continuous bonded winery, but it's still here. And some of the oldest vineyards in the oldest vines in the Rogue Valley are at Valley View Winery in the Applegate Valley, which was founded by Peter Britt. So he brought here originally Mission grapes from California. And but he also continued to expand and explore his vineyard and planted almost any grape variety that he could get his hands on, which probably included some of the first Pinot Noir, Cabernet Sauvignon, and Zinfandel in the state. And then there's still some very ancient Mission grapes and Zinfandel on the property as well. So the 1870s really was the largest period pre-prohibition for grape growing in the Rogue Valley. But there were up to 100 acres actually planted at that time. And then with prohibition, most of those plantings ended up getting torn out and being replanted to orchards. So many pear, peach, apricot, cherries, a real mecca for orchard fruit growing in the Rogue Valley. And it's still a very important part of the Rogue Valley today. That's one of the things that's also pretty interesting about the Rogue when you're down there is that you have so many different viewpoints. It's not just a valley full of vineyards. There's so many different things to do and see. So orchards and hiking and mountain biking and river rafting. There's a lot to do down here and spend some time. So wineries are just part of the experience in the Rogue Valley. So post prohibition winemaking was really thanks to Peter Lombard, who was the agricultural professor at Oregon State University. And he revived the grape growing in the valley here in 1967 and really worked with some of the first pioneers, post-prohibition pioneers of the valley, Dick Troon, the Weisingers, the Lane family. And so this professor planted test plots of Bordeaux and Rhone varieties and Iberian varieties on the campus and continued to educate and teach these new growers who were interested in planting vineyards about how to grow grapes. Charles Curry, who also was in one of the first vineyard holders in the Willamette Valley, actually worked with Dick Troon here to set up a viticulture course in the Southern Rogue Valley. So really investing in the small group of intrepid farmers who are looking to plant grapes down here. So Dick Troon, you see him there, planted grapes in 1972. Oops, none of my things are lined up. And he really focused on some really beautiful varieties, Zinfandel, Bordeaux varieties, Vermentino, Tanat, a lot of different grape varieties were grown there and continue to be grown at Troon Vineyard. And we'll go into Troon a little bit later in the Applegate Valley. So in 1991, the Rogue Valley AVA was officially recognized by the TTB. And then in 2000, it received its first nested AVA, the Applegate Valley. So you can see those two regions in those little cutouts. So really starting to get a developed and core group of winemakers by the early 2000s. And then in 2009, there are nearly 2,000 acres under vine and 113 vineyards with about 42 bonded wineries. But by 2020, in just 10 years, both the planted acreage and the number of wineries has tripled in size, and the number of vineyards has doubled. So showing the real interest and ability to enter the market and explore the Rogue Valley down here. So it's pretty accessible, and the grape varieties are pretty interesting to be able to work with. So many of the northern states wineries are also working with fruit from the Rogue Valley as well. And Rogue Valley is, you know, it is not often seen on labels so much in the north, but a lot of the Pinot Noir that is grown in the Rogue Valley actually supports a lot of the Oregon appellated appellated wines in the state. So usually about one in four of your bottles of wine are coming from the Rogue Valley. And biodynamics and regenerative and organic farming really thrive in the Rogue Valley as well. Because of these hot, dry summers, there's very low disease pressure in the Rogue Valley. And also because of these forceful winds that come in off the Pacific, by the time they reach the Applegate and Bear Creek valleys, they're quite dry, these winds. And so there's really very low disease pressure. And so we find when you're in the area talking to farmers and grape growers, there's a lot of organic farming. And not just organic grape growing, but organic farming and regenerative farming in general. And this is an image of the first regenerative organic certified farm or winery in the state, which is Troon Vineyard. And we've got an intern there who's filling cow horns with biodynamic preparations and also introducing sheep into the vineyard and onto the land to create that full circle approach to farming practices. The Applegate Valley specifically are really deep into biodynamics, and it's a very deep part of the culture in that area, and a lot of community building and sharing of information, sharing of biodynamic preps and of machinery as well happens in the Applegate Valley. So an area to keep your eye on for really transparent and naturally farmed wines.
And now a word from our sponsor. Did you know that Dracena Wines has a wine club? We named it the Chalk Club. Draco is on our label, but Vegas was getting a bit jealous, so we decided he deserved to be our wine club spokesdog. In Las Vegas, betting chalk means that you are betting on all of the favorites, and we're gambling that once you taste our wines, we will become one of your favorite wineries. The club is simple, yet a bit different than most. We don't ask for a lot of commitment like others do. Choose between three tiers: the Sweet 16, where you'll receive three bottles twice a year and get 25% off all orders. Sign up for the Elite 8 and get 30% off all orders and receive four bottles twice a year. Or make it to the Final Four and receive six bottles twice a year, as well as receiving 35% off all purchases. All tiers receive discounted shipping, are customizable, and are eligible for unlimited referral bonuses. Add $15 to your bank for each person you refer. Head to www.dracenawines.com or the link in the show notes to find out all the Chalk Club has to offer and to sign up. We've stocked the odds so that you can get our award-winning wines without breaking the bank.
So the Rogue Valley itself, as I mentioned, was created in 1991. Its total area is about 5,600 acres of land. It's 2.5 million. And then planted area is about 5,000 acres, nearly 6,000 acres. So the predominant soils are mainly the stream sediments, and you can see the detailed depth of the Rogue River and the Applegate Valley in this area. And if you look at the Grants Pass region, This area is really a slightly lower elevation as it comes into the town of Grants Pass and really follows the river through Gold Creek and this east-west flow of the Rogue River, which creates an ability to have both north and south facing vineyards. And this, when talking to growers at Del Rio and winemakers there, they're really looking for these cooler north-facing sites to be able to grow their Pinot Noir and Chardonnay and get really minerally vibrant acid and fruit profiles in their Pinot Noirs and Chardonnays. They also grow a lot of Pinot Gris in this area. It's a nice wide, sort of an amphitheater of a basin that captures a good amount of heat during the summer, but also you're able to take advantage of these different aspects of slope and valley floor aspects. So as you move further south, you start to get into a little bit more of these volcanic uplifts that have really, you have a lot of degraded volcanics as well, which create a lot of diversity of soils here and make for wines that can be very long lived and very structured. They are important because you have a lot of clay in these soils as well, and that clay helps to retain some of the water for the growing season. So not relying so much on irrigation, and really winemakers and grape growers in this area are experts with deficit irrigation to make sure that they're balancing the plant's ability to create and set fruit and build ripeness and flavor, really deep, complex flavors in their Bordeaux varieties and Rhone varieties. And some of the most exciting Malbecs and Bordeaux blends are coming out of this little area just east of Medford along the I-5 corridor there. So you're starting to still be on valley on old alluvial riverbed systems, but you're starting to get those imprints of deep volcanics and a lot of cobbles in the soils as well. So really getting some nice complexity from that complexity of soils and the ripeness that comes from having the reflection of these darker soils and also the cobbles that are along the vineyards in this area. They really reflect back onto the grapes and create incredibly complex, savory Syrahs and Grenache varieties and Cabernets as well. Really supple tannin profile that winemakers have to watch not to over extract, but there's a lot of structure and a lot of complexity to these wines. And the majority of these wines are very accessible. They're quite, you know, the tasting rooms are open. What I love is that the tasting rooms here are often open until like 7 or 8 at night, and you're having, you know, you're able to enjoy these tasting rooms right after work or at the end of your day after you've been out hiking or biking or on the river, and enjoy some really fine wines here that are often less than, you know, $40 or $50. So super approachable wines. We just need to get more of them out in distribution. Moving south into Ashland, you start to get into these really high elevations here, and the gap in the mountains starts to narrow here, and so winds really can accelerate pretty quickly through the Cascades and the Klamaths here in this area. So the soils here tend to be more deep sandstone as well, so very free draining. The roots have to dig very deep for nutrients, but it makes some really vibrant and fine Pinot Noirs and Chardonnays, and also again Malbecs are really excelling in this area as well. That is the majestic Rogue River. It is pretty dynamic to go rafting through this river, and it's freezing cold, so just be warned, but it is beautiful. So these river and tributaries of the Rogue, the Illinois, the Applegate, and the Bear Creek Bear Creek rivers are really what defines the Rogue Valley. And again, that Illinois Valley being very aromatic, perfumed grape varieties, Riesling, Pinot Blanc, Gewurztraminer, Muscat, Pinot Gris, very fresh, very acid-driven, Pinot Noir that is very forested and raspberry and strawberry flavors, really exotic, high acid, delicate, ethereal wines out in the Illinois Valley. And then moving into the Applegate, you still get a lot of those grape varieties on higher elevations because, again, we're still at around 1,600 feet elevation for a lot of the vineyards here. And so they're very fresh, bright flavors of wines. And then as you move towards the east, you start to get into that wider, warmer Bear Creek Valley, where the amphitheater of the site and the Cascades really start to hold in a lot of that warmth and heat in the summer, which allows us to really ripen beautiful Cabernet Sauvignon and Malbec and Merlot and Grenache and Syrah on that eastern side as well. So each valley getting progressively warmer and drier as they move from the west to the east, further away from the Pacific. And again, a pretty complex and diverse array of grapes and wine styles being made here. So you can really start to explore the Rogue Valley by getting into, you know, some fun wines like sparkling Pinot Gris and fresh citrus-driven Chardonnay that then move into some of the more savory food-friendly styles of wines, those Rhone varieties and Bordeaux varieties. So this is an image of Del Rio vineyards that are located just outside of Grants Pass. So they're just to the southeast of Grants Pass. And this vineyard, although it doesn't look like it here, it rises fairly quickly from, you know, about 800 feet up to about 1600 feet. And as you move further up the hill, you're getting into more of the perfumed and floral Pinot Noirs that they make from this site. It's one of the largest vineyards and wineries. This is not their only vineyard, but this is a pretty important vineyard and winery in terms of production of very high quality, but very accessible market entry Pinot Gris and Pinot Noir and Chardonnay. And they're also having a lot of fun with their Joy wines that are really pretty engaging and just really fun to drink when you're on the river or going hiking as well. So lower alcohols, fresher fruit flavors, and a lot of complexity coming from this vineyard, depending on where you harvest your fruit from. So when you're visiting this northern part of the Rogue Valley, you can really find everything from Pinot Noir and Pinot Gris through to Malbec as well in this area, and Cabernet Sauvignon and Merlot. But a really well-established farming family in the north here that is part of this really important community. Or an important part of this community. Then as we move south, we're heading to Medford. So the town of Medford, which you can just see in the distance there, Roxy Ann Vineyard sits under the Roxy Ann Peak, and that's one of those basaltic volcanic columns that seem to be stacked. It's an incredibly vibrant countryside down here where Roxy Ann and Crissel and Two Hawk are all located along this eastern side of the benchlands. And you can see, so behind the vineyard, you're starting to get into more scrub bush. And then as you're looking towards the south and west, you're starting to see more of those conifers and typical, you know, forested scenes. This vineyard is very well known for its great Grenache and Merlot and Rhone varieties here as well. So you can see from the soils, they're pretty free draining. Again, sustainability is really key in these areas. And most wineries that you speak to are really working hard in the vineyard. You can see the cover crop here that's, you know, maintaining soil carbon and bringing diversity and protecting that evaporation evaporation of water and really slowing down the competition within the vines there as well, allowing for a really delayed ripening process that just builds complexity. So the more, you know, competition and health in the vineyard that we can have, the more complex and slower ripening the fruit becomes, which adds to really complex flavors and fully ripe and supple tannins at harvest. And you can see in the distance there, there's orchards as well on this property. And then just east of Ashland is the absolutely stunning Irvine and Roberts Vineyard and Winery. And you can see here in this picture, this is looking towards the Cascades. So you're looking east here, but again, you can see the compression and the rippling of the Cascades here, and those really important volcanic and basaltic and sandstone outcrops that are just, you can see that there's so little topsoil here that these vines really have to establish themselves pretty quickly and grow really deep root systems to be able to access water and nutrients in the soil here. And this vineyard is one of their younger vineyards that they've just planted. And Irvine and Roberts, they're very high elevation. So their sites are 1600 to 2000 feet. The wind through here is pretty dramatic as well, but they really focus on Pinot Noir and Pinot Meunier and Chardonnay. So very delicate, fresh, ethereal styles of Pinot Noir, a little riper than you'll find to the north, but definitely not as ripe as what you would find in, say, you know, Alexander Valley or some of the Californian areas. So they walk this really beautiful line of having deep fruit flavors. But because of the diurnal shift that happens between nighttime and daytime temperatures here, the acid is really preserved and the freshness and aromatic fruit flavors are really lifted and brought to the fore. And again, this is an organically farmed vineyard, and there's just so many organically farmed sustainable wineries in this area. It's a really beautiful place to visit. So moving into the Applegate Valley, we're starting to move to the west of Ashland. So if you travel west of Ashland, you will run into Jacksonville, which is an adorable town that looks like an old gold mining town, which it is. But there's just a really beautiful, you know, Shakespeare Festival. There's a lot of fantastic farm-to-table restaurants here in Ashland and in Jacksonville. And that entire area is really getting quite renowned for the quality of the produce that comes from the area and just how much support there is for all of that food and great food and wine in the local restaurant. So really a place to watch is Ashland and then Jacksonville, which is just west of it at the beginning of the Applegate Valley. So this Applegate River system, you can see the road actually follows the river up to Highway 9, but there's several roads that crisscross the valley, the Applegate River Valley here, and really allow for a lot of varied vineyard growing aspects. The majority of vineyards in the Applegate Valley are high elevation sites, but a lot of them are planted on alluvial stream sediment because, like the Rogue River, the Applegate River has moved several times. It was typically much higher, and it's moved down lower as, you know, as the whole region has changed over the millennia. The Applegate River does begin in the Siskiyous and Klamaths in California, and that flows north into the Rogue River in Grants Pass. So Tom, I would say that Forest is one of those wineries that really make really lovely ethereal Pinot Noirs. There's also Danson, and then Irvine and Roberts, because of that Heightened elevation, again, really makes beautiful Pinot Noirs as well. I have been so impressed with the quality of Pinot Noir in this region that I think that we're going to start seeing a lot more producers really focusing on it instead of selling fruit to the north. The Pinot Noir is really expressive coming from this region. And then you also get the deep, you know, the really deep, peppery, savory Syrahs and Grenaches as well. And just because of this high elevation and the freshness of the sites, there's a lot of really food-friendly wines coming out of this area that have, you know, lower alcohol levels or moderate alcohol levels, ripe fruit, but vibrant acidity as well. One of those producers is Herb Quaddy in the Applegate Valley as well, who's really had quite a long relationship with those Rhone varieties. So Syrah is what he really focuses on, but also Cabernet Franc and Merlot and Vermentino all grow really well in the Applegate here. So this valley is starting to carve out a little name for itself for being a little more Mediterranean in its approach. So you get everything from Syrah and Grenache and Marsan, Roussan and Viognier through to Vermentino and a little bit of Merlot, Cabernet Franc, really vibrant wines. And Quaddy North just have a beautiful, just opened a really beautiful new winery and tasting room facility out in the Applegate on his property, where you're surrounded by old vineyards, as old vines as well. There's so many high elevation sites and so many mountain ranges in the Applegate Valley that you feel almost like you can't look out, you know, like there's a lot of shading and shadowing, and it's just, it feels very alpine and very, very stunning. So all of these stream sediments and benchlands reveal a lot of fractured granites and other cobbles in the vineyard as well. So the soils are much more free draining. Again, it's a very organic and biodynamic focused region and really excels in some of these medium bodied, fairly complex Southern Rhone, Southwestern France, Iberian varieties. And one of these wineries, Plaisance Ranch, is a vineyard that's on the benchlands on the west bank of the Applegate River, slightly closer to Grants Pass, but it's has the Applegate River flowing right behind it. And Joe Genet is the grower here. He runs a, he raises cattle, organic farmed cattle, as well as planting probably some of the most diverse grape varieties in one vineyard in Southern Oregon. So he has Mondeuse and Sauvignon Blanc and Viognier and Persan, and really is following a lot of his family's heritage, which although he's born and raised in the Rogue Valley, his family comes from the Savoie region in France. And so he's really followed that path. And many people don't know, but Plaisance Ranch was an important provider of rootstock when UC Davis had given out AXR1 to a lot of wineries and vineyards in California, and those rootstocks started to fall susceptible to phylloxera. The Genets have a rootstock nursery that they supply many clean plant materials to the universities in California and even as far as Canada, the Okanagan and Toronto for this plant material and rootstocks. So a really important contributor to the Applegate Valley. It's a lot of fun to visit out here. Yes, Simple Machine Pinot Noir. I love the wines from Simple Machine. There's so many fun producers. There's a collective now in talent that has three or four different producers in there where you can taste, you know, all of their different wines from. And it's such a treat to taste everything from Sangiovese through to Malbec through to Tanat in that area. So this is Troon Vineyard on the western side of the, the eastern side, the right bank of the Applegate River. Troon has recently been in the press, I'm sure many of you have seen, for becoming the first certified regenerative organic winery and vineyard. And what that means for this area is just a huge leap in a lot of knowledge sharing about how to bring animals and do animal husbandry in the vineyard, how to nourish the soils through organic animal compost and fertilizer. It's a real treat to visit out here and visit their production. They're spending a lot of really good time and money on education of not only the vineyards and wineries in the region, but explaining the importance of biodynamics and regenerative organic farming to the consumer as well. So definitely, yeah, Catalyst Wine Collective and Talent. Amazing place to visit, and some really fun young winemakers who are making really high quality wines in that collective space as well. And Troon recently, so Dick Troon was one of the first to plant vines in the Applegate Valley, and really came together with the Lane family to expand their plantings, and then the Schmitz and the Genets to all share that wealth of knowledge of planting in the late 70s and 80s. And many of those vines have had to be replaced, but what they learned from a lot of those vines that were in place, the Vermentino, the Zinfandel, and the Tanat, they've learned that, you know, there's a lot of diversity that can really be supported in this vineyard. And so the Troon team are exploring even further with Fiano and some other, you know, Italian and Mansang and all of these different vibrant Southwest and Italian and Iberian varieties in the region. So it's going to be a fun place to keep your eye on and to watch for and explore all of the wines that are coming out of Troon. So that's one of the images of harvesting Vermentino. So you can see how vibrant that vineyard is. Still at the end of harvest, really lush, healthy vines and beautiful golden Vermentino clusters sitting there. And then this is Cowhorn Vineyard. This is on a further tributary of the Applegate River, heading more towards Illinois, and is actually the vineyard that is closest to the California border. So just over those hills is California. But this is a very wild vineyard. It's a lot of head-trained vines, primarily Rhone varieties, so Grenache, Syrah, Marsan, Roussan. There's a little bit of Tempranillo here as well, but biodynamically certified and biodynamically made wine. And as you can see, it's slightly more dry and a little more wild and dry brushlands than the other side of the Applegate River Valley. So even within such a short river valley, there's so much complexity of soil, of microclimate in this place. It's a really beautiful area to explore, and really rich, intense flavored wines that have great freshness and transparency and really reflect the climate and the growing season down here. And there's more and more winemakers that are continuing this path in the Rogue Valley of organics and biodynamics, and showing real restraint in the cellar and putting all of this great creative work into the vineyard. That's the end of the presentation. Are there any questions out there from anyone? I know it's a bit of a whirlwind to come through the Rogue Valley when there's so many different grape varieties and regions that are really, you know, micro regions, sub regions that are really quite impressive and quite a lot to discover. You could honestly spend a week here every month or every other week, just to get to know the entire valley down here. And the amazing thing about the Rogue is that it's continually changing. It is such a place that is really fun to explore and continuing to change all the time. Peter William Winery, yes, also making some great wines. And that's the beautiful thing, is that the comparison across price points for the Rogue Valley wines, you know, in comparison to some other regions like Walla Walla or the Willamette, there's a lot of very affordable wines in this area as well. I think that's generally, so the question was, what is more economical? Is it you know, orchards or vineyards in regards to the inputs and the spraying? You know, I think that there's a good balance of both here. There's a lot of wineries and vineyards that also grow fruit and, you know, orchard fruit. And so I think what that means is that it's just a region that's not homogenized by the grape or by wineries. And so they really do, it's a very true agricultural region where they're farming for, you know, quality fruit and quality grapes. And you can sort of farm them side by side. You see a lot of, you know, the vineyards that are more on the valley floor are, there's not so many vineyards on valley floors. The orchards are better on the valley floors. And then as you start to creep up into the surrounding hillsides is where you really start to get the grapes coming in. And it's, you know, high quality production there, but they're often grown by the same people. There's even a couple of wineries who, you know, who do both farm to table, you know, who can go and you pick fruit and also then go and have a tasting. So there's some fun events out there. There was a question about distribution. Talk a little bit about distribution strategies for smaller and mid-sized wineries in the Rogue Valley. You know, I think one of the challenges, you know, for Rogue wineries is that they have such a localized fan base that a lot of them sell out. A lot of the wineries are less than, you know, around 3,000 cases or 5,000 cases, which is not too dissimilar to the Willamette Valley by any means. But the surrounding areas of, you know, Medford, Grants Pass, Ashland really support their wineries. And so there hasn't really been a huge need for distribution from the Rogue Valley. However, you know, there are some Troon, Quaddy North, Irvine and Roberts, they all have distribution. And, you know, most of the distribution that suits them are, you know, smaller, obviously smaller distributors around the US, and ones that are used to, I guess, you know, smaller family farms and organic family farms. So small French producers, you know, or with a focus on some French and Spanish and small Italian producers, but generally smaller distributors would be able to better position a lot of the wineries from the Rogue Valley, because not all of them have, you know, the volume of like Del Rio to be able to support larger distributors. And they're definitely, Del Rio is definitely well distributed, especially in the Northwest here, but a lot of the others, you know, are only having, you know, a handful of wines available at a time. But if you're looking for the wines around the country, you'd look out for Del Rio, Quaddy, Troon, Irvine and Roberts, Roxy Ann. There's a fair few that are well distributed. And then, yes, there's always the best way to support everyone is through Wine Club and the Rogue Valley Wineries Association. Rogue Valley Vintners has just actually launched its own wine club. So if you are interested, you can definitely, Gina's just put the link to that Rogue Valley Wine Country.com wine club. They'll be sourcing, sommelier sourcing, and putting together shipments. And the next shipment goes out in June. So if you're interested and in the US, please sign up for that to get a taste of the Rogue Valley at home, and then come and visit. Thanks everyone for tuning in today. I really appreciated you coming and learning about the Rogue. Come out and visit when the next time you're headed to Oregon. It really is a spectacular region to visit, and is not just about wine, but it's a great region to explore both the topography and geology of the region through the wines in the glass. So Resource Studio, this deck can be made available as well. And there's also the Resource Studio, which you can download and, you know, talk about, yeah, be able to transform your own decks and presentations. If you do have any questions about downloading any of the Resource Studio decks, please reach out to myself or to David, and then continue to watch for more Oregon Wine Month webinars. We've got at least two more, and I think we have a third that we're going to focus on some future farming and have some really interesting farmers on the panel there, one of them who will be from the Rogue. So be sure to tune in for that. I think David has that up on the website now to sign up for. It's going to be a really great session. So we've got three more to go, and get out there and drink some more Oregon wine.
This has been another episode of Exploring the Wine Glass. Thanks for listening. If you have suggestions on what topics you would like me to discuss, please reach out on social media. You can find me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook as Exploring the Wine Glass. I am also on LinkedIn as Lori Hoytbud. Of course, you can always email me at exploringthewineglass@gmail.com. If you enjoyed what you heard, please rate, review, and subscribe to help others find me more easily. And most importantly, tell your wine-loving friends, because if you like the podcast, they will too. Music is Wine by Kevens. Until next week, Sláinte. You are so special, you even in the Bible. Give me the red wine, give me the white wine, give me the sweet red wine.